More than 50 years ago, four young radicals began arguing politics with one another at the City College of New York. In argument, they discovered the world. Through the power of their ideas, they hoped to change it.
Ever since I can remember, I've been a neo-something. A neo-Marxist, a neo-Trotskyist, a neo-liberal, a neo-conservative. In religion, always neo-Orthodox, even while I was a neo-Trotskyist and a neo-Marxist. I'm going to end up a neo. Just neo, that's all. Neo-nothing.
I think that one of the difficulties that we face today is that there is a deep moral and intellectual crisis of the American ruling class. Don't ask me who the ruling class is. Whoever it is, it's a deep crisis.
You know who you are.
But I see you've got an article, your lead piece, called Who Owns the Future? And I don't know if you know that Irving Kristol wrote a piece a few years ago called Who Owns the Future? I suppose that's everybody's patent, that they claim the future. Problem is, who's the who? I mean, the future, we know what that is. It's all bleak.
If you would have asked me, I would tell you. When I came to Berkeley in 1964, I still thought of myself as a man of the left on a number of grounds. But they were grounds that could well have been from the right.
A powerful critic of liberal welfare policy and an eminent sociologist, Nathan Glazer has done pioneering work on ethnic identity. Irving Kristol is a political essayist and a key intellectual architect of the Reagan and Gingrich revolutions. A literary critic and leading voice of the left, Irving Howe has dedicated his life to keeping the socialist idea alive. Daniel Bell is a man of the liberal center. A major social theorist, his work has been pivotal to our understanding of the late 20th century. As young men, they were drawn into the world of the New York intellectuals, a brilliantly contentious circle of writers and critics who combined a love for art and literature with an equal passion for politics.
If I try to think about the New York intellectuals, and specifically about these four New York intellectuals, one of the most striking things about them, and which distinguishes them from their academic peers and from some of their successors, both left and right, is a way of thinking about the world. You can't begin to analyze, say, the most recent strike in Detroit without starting from the division of labor in ancient Babylonia and working your way up. And you, that's the context. The context is world history. And the questions that you bring to your analysis of this specific event are the largest questions. Where are we going? Where have we been?
They came from working class families. And they made their way on, the children made their way on their wits.
Growing up in the Jewish world of New York, even though one had religious education, did not make one primarily religious, it made one more alert to the world. It was a kind of double consciousness. We'd go to school and we'd sing, "My country, 'tis of thee, sweet land of liberty." Land where my fathers died, people say, Russia. Land of the pilgrims brought, Jerusalem, from every mountainside, the Alps.
The immigrant Jews brought with them memories of the old country, legends and stories about things that have happened there. So you absorbed this kind of historical consciousness at the kitchen table, literally at the kitchen table.